Do you remember the total mindfuck when, when to my face, Brant would deny that he was spearmint nitrate and then go on the internet and release a video in which it's interspersed with him exactly aping spearmint nitrate's work? Man. And I'm like, is this fucking with me? What is going on? That's a true thing. Let's start the show! Is there music happening?
There is.
Yes, there is.
Oh,
great. We can't hear it. That means it's got to be go time. The show full of horseshit and shenanigans. It's Night Attack, bringing you the best of the worst of the internet ever since anybody cared. I'm live from our LA studio, joined by both Tom Merritt, our gracious host, and of course, my BFF and OIK. It's JRY. What's going on, Justin?
What's up, folks? Welcome to yet another edition of the show. A show that earlier today had both of Brian and I in the same place at the same time, but I had
right,
to flee
right here in this very place
with your
actually,
head
yeah.
laying on that pillow.
On that pillow, I was sleeping there last night, but I had to break out. I had to get back to Oakland because I'm off to WrestleMania this weekend, so I had to get my affairs in order. But man, why we were in LA is going to be the bulk of this show.
Yeah. Dude, there's a story. I kind of feel like I
can't wait to find out.
In fact, Tom was asking all about it, and I just was like,
"Nope,
I'm saving it for the show. Just
you.
All of it." But I feel like we could begin with the as if it's an indie film. We could begin with a vignette of the end of the evening, which wraps up at 2 a.m. Let's start at around 1:15 a.m. this morning. 1:15 a.m. this morning, we walk out of Tom Merritt's house, walk down about a half mile down the street, right? And as we're doing it, we're opening up apps looking for bars, and we get all the way down, and we're walking down the street, and then Justin says, this place is closed. I was like, what about this place? He's like, no, that's closed. And he's like, Brian, it's Monday night. I think every single bar on this street is closed. And I was like, well, let's walk. Maybe we could buy a six pack. Maybe there'll be a quickie mart or something.
Let's just go to a gas station, a liquor store, something like that. We'll find just a sixer. We'll bullshit and go to sleep. Because really, at this point, this is Brian and I having to get really kind of emotionally invested in something. And then just needing some kind of blow off steam relaxation because Brian was sleep deprived and I had to wake up for a flight at 5 o'clock in the morning. So it's just like we needed to wind down and go to sleep as fast as possible.
Yeah. Basically, it's like we're on a mission. It's like we need to flip some switches because Justin's got to be up and at the airport. In what time did you have to get up for your flight today?
I wound up getting up around like 5 o'clock, 5 o'clock, 5:20, something like that.
So you got all of like a 2 hour nap.
Pretty much. Yeah.
You were probably still a little bit inebriated when you got in the Uber.
Oh, 100%. Yeah.
Okay.
Oh,
great. but you were in a good space to go, to go to the airport.
Enough. It's like, it's one of those things where I've done it so many times being on the road that, it's
still
the problem. Oh, hey, by the way, did we introduce that Tom Merritt is here? Ladies and gentlemen, from Daily Tech News Show, Sword and Laser, and so many more, including FSL Tonight, it is Tom Merritt. Tom, welcome to the show.
Thank you again. It's good to be welcomed.
So we're walking with the intention of, like, please, just let there be a gas station, let there be a liquor store, whatever. And I'm actually saying... What are the liquor laws here in LA? How late can you buy liquors? Because I know in Texas, like liquor stores, they shut at 9 o'clock. And back when, and Justin can vouch for this, like back when you're on the road all the time, you get real good at knowing local blue laws.
All the different.
Yeah.
Laws. Totally.
But Justin and I, it's been a while for us. We're looking stuff up. And then we hear the halcyon call of the siren song,
retro music. It's just like all accordions and Mexican beats.
and we hear it, and we start walking closer, and we're like, oh, there's that Mexican. I thought of it as a bar. Turns out it's not a bar. It's a Mexican dance hall, and I walk up, and the first thing it hits me is how loud the place is blasting music, which I guess is a form of advertisement, right? Mm-hmm. Kind of like up and down.
Apparently got us in the door.
Yeah, exactly, right? And so security, there's a guy at the door who's wearing a penny vest or whatever, says security. And so I'm like, and we just lock eyes. I'm like, oh, yeah. So I reach in and I pull out my ID to show ID. And then I go to step in, and it's like, hand goes up, and I'm like, what? And he's like, I've got to, and I realize that that he's gonna pat me down, and all of a sudden, this establishment entered a different category in my mind, because this is not a common thing on Sixth Street, right?
Yeah, no, that's funny that my neighborhood has the pat-down bar and Texas doesn't.
Well, I mean, listen, you might have some wild shit go down in there, man. Like there definitely seemed like a very genial crowd. But when I say that this place was a Mexican dance hall, I don't mean that it just was a dance hall that was catered to or favored by Mexican people. This was 100% in Spanish. Nobody was speaking to the bartender in anything but Spanish.
Yes, and we walk in, and there's exactly five men, two playing pool. Actually, there were three when we walked in, and then two more joined after us, and a completely empty back dance hall area with, I think it's safe to say, the loudest Tejano music I have ever heard in my entire life, blasting nonstop.
It was prepared. They were prepared for 200 people to show up on the dance floor and try to have conversations, and they could be blaring the music over it. They were already set. There would be no futzing with that dial.
Well, and which had the weird side effect of in order nobody could have a conversation from more than 4 feet away. And so you did have a couple of people singing along with the songs, and they knew every word, right? But then we would just hear a wild line of the like they would toss it back and forth to each other, like as if it's code to say, I am having a good time and it's good to see you. And to which they say, I too am happy to see your face here again. And Justin and I, and again, when you hear about the day, how long it was, we mosey up to this bar, sit down, and there's this big mural of a naked woman, and there's a hand drawn list of all the beers and stuff, and this lovely woman comes over, middle aged woman, and I'm like, do you have whiskey? And she goes, no. And I look around and I realize that it's a beer only establishment. And I think, oh, that's right. We're not at a bar. We're at a dance hall that will have beer and wine, right? And so then I just, you know, out of exhaustion, I'm just like, Dos Equis, you know. And in they come. Justin grabs a Tecate. We settle in at the bar. The phones come out. And we sit there. Totally silent, playing Hearthstone for the next 45 minutes.
Only briefly looking over to the other one's phone and being like, nice play. That's a good play. Oh, man, that's great. By the way, Max Trollbot in the Twitch chat points out accurately that we indeed were Dos Amigos Blancos. That was who we were in that establishment.
Well, so the nice thing was after yelling Dos Equis only once, it was only a game of looking and establishing meaningful eye contact, and then her looking over and holding up one finger, and me holding one more right back.
No, Brian, I went full bore. I mustered up all
the skills that seventh grade Spanish taught me, and just hit her with a uno más.
No. And she said, "Sure, no problem."
Yes, sir.
Probably
patronizing cunt. So all right, so that's how the night ends.
Well, hold on, I did have an awkward moment where there was a decision gate. I don't know if you even saw it, because the music was so loud from just one side that I was seriously thinking I was going to have hearing loss.
Ryan is shoving napkins in his ears because, like, if there's one way to make us look even weirder besides being the only two white guys in the Mexican dance hall at 2 o'clock in the morning is to have my friend with his Dobby the house elf white ear just like sticking out while he signals to the bartender that he indeed would like one more, whatever you were drinking, Modelo's.
Exactly. But that was a long negotiation to get to that point where it's just like, I'll just cover this ear. I'll just look like I'm leaning on this ear. And then it's like, man, I bet I could get, and I just kind of roll it up and I put it in and I'm like, oh, that's very effective. I'm just going to keep leaning on it and nobody will know that I have double layers of protection for my hearing. And then at some point I was like, well, only Justin will see it on this side. And so then I switch the move and do the other ear and lean over. And then at some point I'm just like, yeah, fuck it. And so I'm just a dumbass playing
hard. Not only is Brian shoving napkins in his ears, but he's pulling out the napkins that lose their friction to his ears and just has a pile of elephant bones in front of him. napkins that had lost their usefulness. Now, meanwhile, last call comes around, and they're like, you know, say in Spanish, whatever, last call over the speaker. And literally, I think it was just to chase us out. Like, everybody else just sat there. Nobody moved. And we just waited
for somebody. It was just like clap, clap, something in Spanish. Go, go. And then just everyone nodding. And then our bar mistress coming over and they're like, man, on credit card? And it's like, all right, we take the int.
You know what, though? When I used to go to the Texas Showdown in Austin all the time,
yeah,
as a regular, they would go around and say, you know, last call. And those of us who were regulars just sat there.
Yep.
You know, because yep, we knew how to stick around after hours and what the secret, you know, procedure was. So it probably is exactly what was going on, right?
Yeah.
It's like you guys were, they're like, oh, well, they're not part of the crowd that's going to stick around for the after hours. So, you know, no offense, guys. Great having you. See you later.
Also, Justin hit rank 8. Congratulations, Justin.
I did. You rank 8, 5 stars.
Ocho.
So yeah, holler at me on this ladder here. But I'll tell you what, we're gonna get into why we were in LA. We're gonna get in. We had an amazing day. It was really, really awesome. But before we do, let's mention that patreon.com/nightattack is where you can support this show. Head on over there right now. You get the pre-show and post-show in their own RSS feeds before anybody else. It goes to you first on for if you are a patron at any level for Night Attack. Again, that is patreon.com/nightattack.
We are $1 away from a milestone. One measly dollar at patreon.com/nightattack.
Yeah, 1600, huh?
Yeah.
I'll tell you what, Brian. Do you want to? Do you have your computer around you?
Oh yeah, you know
it's
what?
Right behind you.
But I've got email set up. I think we could play our favoritest game.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for the Night Attack new Patreon name chant corner hour.
An hour of
it. All right, I glanced over the names. I picked out oh my goodness. somebody made their pledge very, very large, and I'm but I think we might have said his name before. Thank you very much, John Pinkerton, but that's not the person we're calling out, because I just liked this person's name and I don't know what he's doing, but okay. it's somebody who increased their pledge. I assume this person was at a dollar, Now they bumped it up, and that's the great thing. Once you're over a dollar, you don't have to go in dollar increments. Mm-hmm. Somewhere mm-hmm. between one and two, but I don't know what he's doing. I like to think he's fighting crime in space.
Okay, we can't. Everybody can't be fighting crime, Brian. Come on, I'm gonna send this one back to the wood shop. Give me something else other than fighting crime that he's doing. Can be literally anything.
Okay, you know what? I'm gonna say his name, and then you tell me what he's doing, and then we'll cheer for him in whatever he's doing.
All right.
What do you think Deimos Galacticus is doing?
No, he's an asteroid miner.
Fighting crime in space.
His name is Deimos Galacticus.
Deimos Galacticus, we love you.
Thank you, Deimos.
Kick those criminals
into further reaches of space.
All right. Thank you so much, Deimos Galacticus.
Deimos.
What a badass name.
He's
that's so
Deimos
amazing.
Deimos Galacticus.
Yeah. What's up?
Deimos Galacticus.
Of all the Galacticuses, he's Deimos.
The Patreon with Deimos Galacticus.
It's true. All right. So... we were in a movie.
Well, yeah, we're in a movie that's currently filming. Many of you who have watched this show for a while know that our friendship with Romney Malco is something that's been really, really awesome. And also that he Indiegogo'd his Tijuana Jackson prison logic movie partly on this show. He came on and we plugged it, and it hit heights that he was hoping that it would get to. In the end of that show, Romney told us, hey, we're going to put you in the movie. I'm going to write you guys into this movie. I already know what roles you guys would do. And lo and behold, we were in L.A. on a movie set yesterday to shoot our cameos. Where do you want to start with this? Because Brian, my initial thought is to start with us getting the scripts.
Well, yes, I think so, too, because to be honest, I was it was fairly last minute, just a couple of days. I don't know, 3 or 4 days ago. It's like, hey, we're picking your shoot day. Get ready. And I was like, oh, I better get out to L.A. And they send us the script, and the script starts with dialogue between Brian and Justin. They're literally the first characters on the show, and they have a scene or whatever. And then, but then I read the email. It says, you're parolee number one and parolee number two. Your scene's very funny. It was hard to find our thing so Brian and Justin were going to be us, but then they, I guess they either consolidated our roles or they changed the nature. I figured that they wrote too much.
What happened was, we were going to be, and we were told by Romney that we were going to be the documentarians behind the camera of this mockumentary. So there's a lot of lines that were in the script there already that were Romney or other characters talking to these characters. So they are omnipresent throughout the entire film, but there would only be one or two scenes where you'd see them on camera and they would have dialogue.
Correct. And I just assumed that either the characters got fleshed out so much that, well, they're gonna have them be real characters, and you're gonna need real actors to do it, right? But meanwhile, we look at it's you know, little scene with parolee number one and number two. It's funny. It's very funny.
I don't know why you're rolling over that, because like, initially, he described it to us like we would just kind of have those token cameo lines where it'd literally just be like, do you have the film? Yeah, I got the film, right? Like, just something that's like token dialogue that puts us on screen, and that's his payback. But we got those lines, and not only are we not only interacting with each other, which I also thought was going to be a no-brainer, we're acting with somebody else, and the lines that we have are like,
funny. Like, they're, like, bantery, kind of, like, going back and forth, like, comedic lines. Like, we have to carry a portion of this movie. It's a brief portion, but, like, there's a point in which the camera swings over to us and the film asks, all right, guys, hold everybody's attention.
Yeah, and smash cut, and we'll get there, but in that moment when it's like, okay, it's time to do your scene, and you see the massive number of people, all of whom have been overworked, they're super stressed, the production is a nightmare. I mean all production is, right? It always goes long, you're working 16, 20-hour days and so on, and then lights are on, and they're like, okay, to people who have never acted in a movie, and be funny, go, money on the line, everybody watching, don't screw anything up, let's go. That's a surreal moment.
Before that happens, there was something that I'm sure is well known to people who have worked in any kind of production, television production, movie production. It is a little thing called hurry up and wait.
Oh,
our
gosh,
call God. Time for the production was when, Brian?
3 p.m. 3 p.m.
Don't be late. On the dot. 3 p.m.
Yeah.
Expected to
be
here.
Yeah, of course. I mean, that's the professional thing to do. Yeah.
Well, Brian didn't come from Austin. I didn't come from Oakland for us to be late to this. We're showing up for Romney. This is going to happen. This is not only a big deal for our friend, but he's also directing it, which is a huge deal for him. Like, this is a huge, huge thing that we do not want to miss by a red second.
Yes.
Brian, when did we start filming?
Well, hey, hold on. I know how this goes. I've done productions. Like, I haven't done a movie, but I've done productions. It's plenty of time. It always takes a lot longer to hold up shoot, get the lighting right. You wait for planes. So you had to wait an hour or two. I get it.
It so, was so around.
You would guess, Tom, 5? If our
I'd
call
say
time
5,
was 3.
Yeah. 5, maybe even 6. I mean, these things take some time.
Yeah, go ahead. Everybody get your guesses in the chat right now. Just everybody go ahead and get your guesses as to when we shot. Because this is not to say that anything was necessarily even going wrong. Like, this is just the nature of production. Like,
it takes time. Exactly. Because like I said, there's all those things that you have to do. You have to get things right, get things in place. Then you do a take, and then you sit down, and then reconstitute a change in angle. It takes time.
Mitzula suggests that it's next Thursday is when the shoot was going to be.
It's still going on.
So I believe it was around 5 o'clock that no.
Okay, so
it was around 5 o'clock that Justin changed his flight because there was a 10:30 flight, and figuring we could get started. And he could roll out tonight because he has to go. He got business to do. Get back home. Knock this out.
Yeah.
And I think we were able to
get everything done. Get everything shot. We're only in one little scene, and then I could be right out to the airport. It's like a 30-minute drive to the airport from where we were shooting. I could be out on the 10:40 flight. I land in Oakland at 11 something. Perfect.
Yeah. I think it was around 7:30. That we started to question whether or not you would make your 10:30 flight.
Yeah.
There's
also a fun
hours.
Moment in between then when we get into wardrobe, which is basically just a t-shirt and shorts. So and like everyone's like, all right, have you guys been to wardrobe? Yeah. Susie, can you please go ahead and get a parolee number 1 and number 2 to wardrobe and makeup? And they're like, okay, cool. Yeah, and they rush us over. And then it's like, all right, put on some shorts. And Oh, that's a great t-shirt. Did you wear that t-shirt because it looks ratty and like something that somebody on their last, legs would wear? And it's like, I mean, no. Like, that's just kind of my shirt. It's like, okay, that's fine. No, it's great. It's perfect.
Yeah, but these shorts are fantastic because they don't match. You got these plaid shorts, and then you're just wearing the solid red shirt with this weird diamond symbol on it on there. I don't know what that means, but like, yeah, I love the mismatchedness and these crazy flip flops. Oh God, we look. This is actually how we dress.
Yeah,
He wrote the script for two Florida tweaker parolees who are denying that they have drugs. And he just wrote the costume very specifically. They're like, yeah, he was very specific about the flip-flops and the shorts and the shirt. And we just showed up in our clothes.
You brought, but you brought options, right?
Yes.
You had other clothes.
They were not necessary. Shirt.
And they're like, don't even go into the bag, bro. You already nailed it. Why are you going to mess with perfection?
Yeah.
Okay, so when did you go into wardrobe?
3:30.
Oh, okay. So when last we met, you were saying Justin was changing his flight at 7:30.
No. He was changing his flight around 5. Well, because we had to break. It was finally mealtime, so around 5 o'clock, and we knew that there was just one more scene to do at the house, and then we could change set locations to where the parole office was going to be. Right. Although reading the script, it seemed as though this was going to take place during the day, but at this point, I mean, it's like the sun's going down.
Yeah, you lost your light.
Right? I mean, I don't know how they're going to deal with that. But we have lunch. They say everything's great. We're going to go do this one last scene in the house, and then we're going to switch locations. And this is the point where Justin and I make a game of trying to keep our energy up and kibitzing, and that's when we run into our new best friend, Sid, who's recording behind the scenes footage for the featurettes, right? And yeah. So Justin and I just start night attacking for 20 minutes until her hand gets tired of holding the camera. But we've given enough filthy bullshit that you know when somebody's just right for Diamond Club and it's just like, oh, okay, normal people don't speak inappropriately like that. But it's like, yeah. We figured it's the set of Tijuana Jackson's movie. It's going to be raw and raunchy and filthy or whatever. And so Sid just starts hanging out with us. We start talking video games and we're in the middle of like making, I believe we were in the middle of talking about snorting a line of cum. If we got enough tokens, and then one of the lovely actors who looked like a gorgeous 22-year-old elegant woman walks over, and Sid just goes, she's 14, and then it was like, whoa, and instantly we got really excited about learning how to do Rubik's cubes because that's what she's into.
That was a lot of the set was a lot of Romney's family. Like this was, I mean, this is an indie budget. Any hand that wants to offer help is welcome. There were a lot of people that I think he called in all of his favors to get people here, not only to shoot the movie, but also to help like with the crew and everything, because they were definitely short staffed, and all the money that was spent was on, you know, production stuff like cameras and the people to use them. So time ticks away. We eventually, the sun goes down at the first location, which, by the way, was supposed to be, according to the call sheet, wrapped at around 2. We were supposed to be at the second location at around 3, right?
So that we could begin shooting no later than 5. And so as we watched the gap between 3 and 5 disappear, you keep thinking like, okay, but we can get over there by 5 and stay on schedule and wrap by 8, just like it says. And then we eventually move over at sunset, which we're around here would be what, around 7 o'clock?
Yeah, it's 7-ish now after day.
So then all of a sudden you do the math and you see just how big a scale. Like, this is a full-on movie production. This is not a dedicated team of 5 doing the modern rogue. This is, you got the lighting team and the sound and all this stuff. And as you start to see the breaking down and the moving and union people and non-union people saying like sticks coming in and all that stuff, it occurs to me like, oh, it's going to be at least an hour until we get over there. And it's around this time.
You're talking about trucks of stuff, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. And it's around this time, Justin looks over and he goes, so midnight, over under. And I was just like, oh, for us to be wrapped by? To be wrapped by, I'll take the under. I think we're going to make it. And he just gives me this withering, patronizing look. He's like, no, Brian, not to be wrapped by. And I was like, oh, wait, you're saying before we start? And he just nods. Now, keep in mind at this point, I feel a wave of despair because, as you guys know, I chronically struggle with insomnia, and I had had a particularly bad night. It was one of those, I went to bed early at midnight and woke up at 3, and that's all I got as I laid there for the rest of the time. So I am just... just buzzing and floaty, and it's hard to feel my hands and stuff. And yeah, just the idea of starting at midnight just crushes my heart, right? So we head on over to the new location.
I assume we're shooting at 4 when I first get there. So I grab a cup of coffee because it's 3. So I'm like, if I drink a cup of coffee now, I'll be like feeling, I'll have my energy up by the time we start shooting.
Yeah, yeah.
Then that kind of passes. And then it's like, okay, I'll have another cup of coffee. Okay. And then it's 6:00. Oh, well, that passes. Now it's 8:00. I guess I'm going to have my third cup of coffee. So now I'm getting that. If you drink a lot of coffee, you ever have like coffee stomach where your stomach is just like, all right, enough. Like it's just too much of this coffee thing. It just feels like hollow. Like you have nothing within your stomach lining.
Well,
go ahead.
We do our best to power through and be professional because the scene is me, Justin, and a parole officer. Okay. And we have dialogue that we are reading for the first time and working it through. And this guy is a legit ass actor. He was in the first season of Daredevil. Super cool. Akim is his name, right?
Yeah, yeah. It's so funny. We were talking to him. We wound up becoming friends during the shoot because we were just kind of hanging out together. But I was like, oh, man, like I was looking at your IMDb. You've been on some really cool stuff. And he's like, oh, yeah, man. Like I was in Daredevil. It's like, oh, like what'd you play? Oh, a thug that gets shot after he pulls a gun on somebody. Oh, OK, cool. And then I did Blue Bloods. Oh, really? What'd you play? Oh, a thug who kidnaps a little white girl and then he gets shot. Like, oh, that's cool. What'd you play on Blindspot? Oh, a thug. I hold up a little girl and then I get shot. And it's like, man, you certainly seem to have a cast that you get typed.
What'd you play on All My Children? Oh, a thug.
Well, and what's funny is he has a radiant smile and the coolest demeanor. And so in this scene,
he's an easygoing guy.
In this scene, the whole point of the scene is he's holding power over 2 tweaker white guys, right? And so Justin asks, like, so is this your first time to play on this side of the law? And he goes, yeah, it is. It's pretty great. but so we try to work out our lines, and we have just barely seen Romney. We hugged and we talked, and Romney introduced us. And it's like, okay, well, we've got time. Let's practice our scene.
Oh, yeah.
And go through it. And so, you know, it's like, well, what do we know? We know it's a comedy. We know that this is clearly meant to be a comedic scene. And so we read it on the script as the power dynamic was the parole officer threatening and lording us, and us being the comic foils who are whimpering and doing stuff. And so, you know, we're doing this ba da da doo ba doo ba da ba in unison 100%, you know, and then we're in the middle of practicing
like, he's kind of playing it like he's this kind of frustrated Keystone cop, right? And we're like the wacky scamp meth heads. And like he's like, well, I'll throw you back in the clink if you don't straighten up. And we're like, man, 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 like doing these like funny little zingers.
And
like,
come on.
Yes. And then we go through a rehearsal, and then Romney.
But okay, at what point in time are you doing this rehearsal?
The sun had gone down, so I think it's 8:00.
Like 8:00.
Now 8:00. We're now in the other location, we think any minute now we're gonna.
Right.
And I'm like, it's probably a night scene, so it's probably fine that it's dark. They probably planned on all of this. It's all part of the plan, I'm sure. So we're in the middle of going back and forth, and there's a comedic rhythm, kind of, you know, because like you would expect if you pictured a comedy is what we were shooting for. And then suddenly Romney turns out to be over Akim's shoulder and just like snuck up and heard us do it. And then our friend Romney took a brief vacation, and instead we got Director Romney, who
understand this, Romney Malco, the all smiles, all charisma bomb man that he is, has been for the last 7 days directing and starring in his own movie. He is in almost every scene. He is directing every scene. He wrote the script, and he has another 7 days to do it after this. And this day has already gone six hours over at this point, right?
Yes.
So he is in survival mode. He is not here to hold our hands and be like, hey, congratulations, you're at fantasy indie movie camp. Like, aren't you guys excited? It is, this scene needs to not only be good, but we need to get it in like two takes because we got to keep moving. Like, so, like, we have already burnt all the daylight.
And I will say his bedside manner was amazing. He began with the beginning. He was like, this scene needs to feel this. The power dynamic is you are so in charge. You're relaxed. You think it's funny that they're in pain. You guys are genuinely terrified because you cannot afford to go back in jail. You need to radiate that fear. Also, you guys are reading the lines as I wrote them. Don't do that. Talk over each other. What you need to do is convey panic. What you need to do is find it hilarious and figure out which one of the ones is the dirty one, right? And
effectively in the tone, and Brian, correct me if this is overstepping.
Sure.
But he basically tells us, you are doing Abbott and Costello. I need The Wire.
Yes. Like, yes. This is all of a sudden, it's just like, no. Guys, you're playing an unironic version of Bubbles, and he's laughing at you. And he, that's, you know, funny. He explained how it's like, this is a documentary. Yes, it is a mockumentary, but everything needs to feel real so that the writing and the cutting is where the comedic beats come from, right? Mm-hmm. But so in that moment, that is a real thing. And then Justin and I, you know, Brian, 3 hours of sleep in the last 36 hours, 48 hours or whatever, is just like gets on the line. And plus, and not for nothing, and I feel good about it now, but one thing both Justin and I noticed about our scene is that it was fairly self-contained, by which I mean, I don't know that the overall narrative would be affected greatly if it was not there.
Effectively what happens, because we are in a parole office, we are the wacky, or we are the thing that is happening in the parole office while Romney walks in and talks with his parole officer, who is, by the way, played by Regina. What's her? Oh, my God. I'm blanking. Regina.
She's in the chat. She's very disappointed.
Regina
that,
King.
She was watching this. She was really Regina excited Hall. If you were going to
no,
mention
no, no.
her.
Regina Hall. From she's been in all sorts of stuff. Scary Movie, When the Bow Breaks, About Last Night, the Barbershop movies. She's great, right? So also, she's in the background of our scene, like listening to us, the guys who have just been told to drastically change the scene. And also, in case you have forgotten, are not actors and do not know what the fuck they're doing. Like, while this intensely tired crew is just like, okay, the 25 people and everybody be perfect, especially the actors, and go.
Get it right the first time.
The good news is, between this initial lesson and between the brief moments of him explaining the power dynamic and what he wants, we have a little time to practice because they are now going to set up lights for day for night shooting, mm-hmm. which means they have to set up so much goddamned light blasting through the door and window, and so much light behind coming from the behind windows that it actually looks like fucking daylights. Like, and I don't mean after color correction, blah, blah, blah. I mean, I am dying and wilting because I'm so fucking tired. And then all of a sudden, it's 9 a.m. again.
But here's the genius of this. And I wouldn't be surprised if Romney actually did this on purpose.
I think after I know where you're headed.
Putting you through all of that, after drinking all that coffee, after being sleep deprived from jet lag, you guys are tweakers that are panicked.
Okay.
No, oh, it definitely read. It definitely read as weird and odd by the time that the cameras actually rolled, which started when, Brian?
10 o'clock, right?
No. We started shooting probably around like 11.
Oh, 15. No, that's right. No, we had to be you in position. Yeah, we had to be in position and everyone started rehearsing because keep in mind, it's not just us. It's not just the pro officer. It's all the background extras. And in the back, you can see Regina Hall and then Romney walks in. And also, though, it's a mockumentary style, right? So that means there's dirty camera work. You have to pull focus from one thing to another because everything is shot from the outside looking in. That's why it had to look so bright on the outside. So while they're finishing that up, Romney spent a good hour. Like, we got a full-on workshop because it's a subtle thing. We knew we were supposed to act scared, but there is a comedic beat that Justin needed to hit that is extremely subtle. It's threading this stone needle where it's like there's too much and there's not enough and there's how it looks on camera. And it's like, okay, that looked good in person, but now I'm seeing it on camera. Let's do it again. Just give me a little more so it reads from whatever. Justin has a very difficult task. So for basically an hour, it was Justin, listen. You're overselling it. I need you. Just look and just think about, you know, you're selling the other guy out, and then that's all it needs. And then it goes, Brian, you look high as fuck, man. It's great. like for an hour, it was me being told how good I looked as a fucked up tweaker.
Justin, like, Brian, you look like a wet pile of shit. This is great, Justin. Again, I mean, I'm trying to fucking tell you, man, like, you can't look too far left or else it looks fake. Relive the character.
And then meanwhile, there was one moment, like at some point, I just never got out of character. And it's like we're clearly in between sessions and I'm still scratching at my chest. And he just goes, look at him. Oh, he's so good. So good.
So we shoot
from our clothes.
So 11 o'clock.
11:15, we start shooting. Once we get rolling and between the adrenaline and everything, I think we do three or four takes. We watch the playback on one of them. And then there was like a technical thing in the middle of it. But we wrap shooting at 11:59. We literally.
So we hit the under. By my under,
yeah.
Like we're walking out to the lift, and I go, Justin, look, and I just hold it up, and it was 11:59.
So you had a way. I mean, all production doesn't hit the time, right? So that's why I was like, 5, maybe 6, way beyond that. But then your shoot, like you started at 11:15 and finished by 11:59. That is tight.
I think we got 6. Takes, each one better than the last, and there was that moment when it was just like, well, I think we got it, and then he watched the review, because keep in mind, Romney is directing and acting.
Yeah, so he has to be on the set, then run back, take a look at the shot.
Well, right? And actually, so he was directing. There's the camera is outside the establishment. We are in the front, being seen through the front window. Way in the back is the office that you can barely see through everything. Behind that is Romney watching what the camera's doing in the background and explains, all right, here's what's going to happen. I'm going to watch just to see that you guys got that we got the take that I want. And then the moment I know I'm happy with what we got, I'm going to start walking in. And so there was so much like us getting started. And then maybe it was the cameraman's fault where it's just like, no, hold on. Or it's like, I'm seeing pink gaffer's tape. And they're like, where? And like, there's no pink gaffer's tape. And then Romney walks out. He's like, what is it? It's like, oh no, it's your socks. You got pink on your socks. Can we get wardrobe? Can we get some socks to put over these socks? And then we go on back. And then it's just like, we start doing our thing. And then eventually we hit this rhythm where, because they want to begin with us in the middle of arguing. So we hit this rhythm and it goes, when I call cameras, you guys start. When I call action, you start with the parole officer interrupting them. And there was a good, like, there was a fucking magical 4 takes of like truly synchronized flow between 40 people hanging around there. It was amazing. Oh,
and that's for how long? How long is that scene?
Oh, sorry. Say it again, Justin.
Sorry, I couldn't hear Tom. I was asking what Tom said.
Oh, he was asking that was for how long of a scene?
Oh, well, I mean, we are the lead in, and I think Romney's just waiting, like, to see if we do good stuff that we could, like, fade into it with, right? But Brian and I wound up, like, against all odds. We're actors, and we got to learn these lines, and then we got to run the lines, and then we got to change the motivation because we didn't realize what was fitting into the movie. Romney guides us there, and then yet here, in this one moment, sleep deprived, I want to shit my pants because I drank so much coffee. We're staring eye to eye with a professional actor while a comedic actress who I have 1,000,000 pounds of respect for patiently waits as a background extra to our scene. Brian and I do Night Attack for the entire crew as part of this movie, whereas parolee number one and parolee number two, what is our argument, Brian?
We went through many iterations. We changed it. We did it every single time, but it was always like, and I think the Skype ducking's gonna fuck it up, but it's just like, it begins with the two of us looking at each other and like we're in the principal's office and we're talking to each other and everyone can hear. And it's just like, no, man, look, I told you the moment you post it, it's going to be on. Are we going to try to do it now, Justin?
I don't know if Skype's going to work, but yeah, just give us the
Oh, okay. So I'm all like, I told you, man, the moment you post it, it's on the internet and it's going to be there forever. And Justin says, you were wrong. It deletes automatically. And I say, nothing deletes from the internet. They can screen cap it. And he's like, it's called burning the image and it does it automatically. That's why it's called Snapchat. And I was like, they can screen capture it. And he's like, but you didn't know that. I said, yes, I was right. And then in the middle of this going back and forth, we did a billion different versions of it, and then we get interrupted, and then we snap to and we go back to denying that we one of us is violating our parole, and then we have to take a piss test, and meanwhile, I don't know, God, I hope it makes it in the movie.
Deleted scenes, at least.
Yeah. Yeah. We'll enjoy watching it on Night Attack.
Oh crap! Hold on. We have footage.
Fuck yes.
What?
We had other people. Oh, this is amazing. Breaking news, people.
All right. Nash, check your Gmail.
Oh.
Keep talking so that we're not just
no,
got a bunch of
no. We're going to sit here and stare.
Jesus.
big shout out goes to Sid and AJ. Sid was the one that we had mentioned earlier. AJ is her partner on this. They are shooting all the behind the scenes for Tijuana Jackson's Prison Logic movie. Man, we are going to crap. All right, maybe I have to download this.
Okay, well, here, while you're working on that, I'll talk to Tom.
Oh, hi, Brian.
I would say it probably was a good, I think Mitsula in the chat has the over under right, like at 36 seconds. I mean, it was definitely a full scene, and I hope a lot of it makes it. And it is a moment of commentary, because I haven't read the whole script yet, but Tijuana Jackson, you know, has a type of character, and I think the commentary of you know, a black parole officer having two white Florida kids mess around. Oh my God, look at this!
Not very, like literally just started, so I know that's not on the same brand as you guys. What's your podcast?
We do. Hey, I'm Brian.
I'm Justin.
We're here with Discovery VR, the new RAV4 platform. Sorry.
It's a fun inside joke.
People love it when they
refer to things that they don't know. Personal life.
You know, when Romney came to us and said he wanted to do a whole movie about two parolees, we were skeptical, but now here we are.
We were like, listen, we demand one thing, that we don't have names.
Yeah, I want to be parolee number two.
And I want to be parolee probably number three.
Number two,
and he was like,
shit.
Fuck you. You got to be number one.
No,
and
that's
like,
true.
Tell you what, give and take. It's what makes the world go around.
You see, he mentioned that he was going to do some other stuff kind of around it, really frame
so this,
it like
this
a picture.
Key, this is the behind the scenes stuff. But let's see if we
can
go
further. Yeah, I think we can skip forward. We'll try to make this available. Oh, shit. Here we are.
This is our scene here. This is at 11 o'clock at night. This is what we're looking at here. That is the sunlight that is streaming through the window. And that is
definitely the moment that I just stopped getting out of character. I just stayed in character at all times.
We have family. Yes. 100%. Of course we're clean. 100%.
Okay. Start over, guys. Start over. Let's read.
So here we go. That is the behind the scenes footage of our scene there. It is man, it was such an experience. I don't know. I don't know if there's anything else after that scene that we could share. But all right, yeah, this is us leaving.
Oh yeah, no, there is one thing, and that's the moment that you couldn't resist fanboying and walked over to Regina Hall to introduce yourself.
Walk over to Regina Hall. I've always loved Regina Hall because she is great at physical comedy and she plays broad really, really well. And that's the same kind of stuff that I really like to do. And so she also is at this point, I think, feeling the drag of an indie movie that has, you know, kind of gone over time. And she like dipped out for a little while to go get dinner and then wound up coming back. Oh, also, real quick sub note, we're like, hurry up and wait, hurry up and wait, hurry up and wait, hurry up and wait. Now, dinner's here. Eat a plate of Buffalo Wild Wings. And then as soon as Buffalo Wild Wings has been consumed, they're like, on set now, let's go, let's go, let's go. So I'm just like totally just like carb crashing when all this is happening. I go to Regina and I say like, hey, listen, I would kick myself if I didn't come by and say hi to you. I'm a fan of your work, and it's definitely been an honor working with you on the same movie. And Regina goes and says, like, hey, you guys were really, really funny. I was trying to keep a straight face back here, but you guys were really funny. And it was everything I could do to keep from laughing. And that was like, man, when you are like ego depleted, like you are when you go through something like that, like having somebody that you respect really, you know, like kind of give you me and Brian the plus one felt really good.
Real quick, we're going to double dip on the patron thing here. I'm going to say we're going to reach out to Sid and AJ and make sure, like, it sounds they acted last night like it was fine for us to share all of this with our peeps because they want all the promotion they can get. I think we're going to make that a patron exclusive. That we'll send out as a bonus to anybody who is doing a Patreon.
Like
thing.
More than what you just saw right now.
The whole thing is 20 minutes. It's 20 minutes of us goofing around backstage. You get to see all the setup for
That's
stuff.
Great.
You get, yeah, I would love to make that happen. Once again, patreon.com/nightattack. Let's shoot for, if you're listening and you feel the call, you get the RSS feed with, you get to double the content with pre-show and post-show. You'll kick us over 1500 patrons. We'll kick over $1,600 and we'll get a 20 minute exclusive that we'll send out as soon as we get permission from the top brass, which I'm pretty sure they already gave, but I just want to make sure.
Yeah. We'll double clear it. You guys will get something. You will get an exclusive look at us shooting the movie. So big thank you to everybody who is already a patron and anybody who becomes a patron between now and the end of the week, which is when
I'm
we will send it.
You should be one too.
Wow. What an,
any
what
an, final, so, any final thoughts?
No, I guess at this point that snaps us back to getting back to Tom's at around, just before 1 a.m. So it was more like 12:45. We sneak in. trying so hard not to disturb the dogs, including have you announced the new dog?
Oh yeah, no, I mean that's public knowledge.
Okay,
so, yeah, we got a new dog. Sawyer is now top dog at 8 years old, and we have a new 1 year old German Shepherd named Ray. And so when I get the text that Justin's going to be here, and I know and already know that Brian's going to be coming in later.
Hold on, can you read the text that exactly as Justin wrote it?
Yeah, yeah. Well, just to clear up the dog story real quick, we actually put the new dog in the kennel because we didn't want her to be jumping around and causing Sawyer to get all upset because we knew that they would bark when you guys come home.
Yeah.
Neither one of them did.
No, dude, they're already so good together. Yeah. Like they're working out those boundaries. But Justin, what did you send to Tom?
So I realized. Oh yeah. By the way, so I obviously realized that I'm not going to make my 10:40 departure flight, and so I move it to early this morning. And I realized that I was staying at Andrew's. It's going to make a lot more sense if I stay at Tom's.
And so we head in.
Yeah, so I just realized, okay, I'm just going to go sleep at Tom's, get up early. So I text Tom. I say, I'm sleeping in your basement. I'll probably be up before you wake up. And then I realize that that's a weird thing to send to somebody. And the only thing that comes to my mind is that a weird thing that's happening, ? Or a Fiona Apple lyric, ?
And by the way, Justin doesn't know this part. I had just laid down and closed my eyes to go to sleep when the text message alert rang. Like I was literally laying down and then I get boom and I pick it up and I read that.
Yeah. So at any rate.
Well, to which Tom responds, I'll be asleep by the time you get here, but make yourself at home. Real thing or Blake Shelton lyric?
Well, I'll be asleep by the time you get here.
We end up sneaking in like ninjas, sneaking out, and having our. I think we're probably the only time in the history of possibly the whole county that two white guys sat in a Mexican dance hall, drank four beers apiece while playing Hearthstone and not talking to each other.
Not talking to each other while one of them had a gigantic piece of napkin hanging out of his ear.
Real thing that happened or MC Frontalot lyric?
All right. Well, hey, man, what do we learn, Justin?
Well, we learned that Romney is an amazing person. We cannot say it enough. Thank you so much. To Romney, his whole family, his girlfriend.
We learned that we have movie draft minutes again.
You guys have missed both the movie draft and Diamond Time. Here's the movie draft.
No. We're not shutting it down. We're just wrapping up the Romney.
That's usually what I say to indicate shutting it down.
What did we learn today? I mean, the show is almost over.
All right, hold on. Wait, before we get into Diamond Time and the movie draft minute, there is one non-Romney thing that I do want to mention. We said this during the draft last week. But our friend of this show, who has come on and just become, especially recently, such a much larger part of Night Attack, Mikey Newman, just spent a bunch of time in the hospital. And it's in Diamond Time. All right.
Yeah.
Well,
oops.
I guess we could just do it in Diamond Time.
Hey, it's time for Diamond Time.
Diamond Time. Diamond Time's the part of the show where we shout out your projects. Head on over to diamondclub.reddit.com. Check out the sticky post. And the top three we get shouted out every single week. Take it away, Justin.
Still a great night.
Here,
I'll just do the one that I was talking about. Bad Weave writes, Diamond Club, it's time to help out one of our own. Many of you are likely already aware of the recent troubles faced by Mikey Newman, and many of you have likely greatly enjoyed his contributions to Night Attack and the internet at large through the awesome movies with Mikey. It's time to pay that forward on his behalf. Please make a donation to the fight against MS via the National MS Society. That is YOLO420.com/WhoNeedsPants. Thank you. That's a reference to the video that is playing right now called I'm Still Here, where a recovering Mikey, and man, you can just hear how much this like week and a half in the hospital where he was like unable to move has taken a toll on his voice and him kind of moving around. It is definitely something that I encourage everybody
to watch. It is a worthy cause, indeed. So go ahead and give love to @MikeyFace on Twitter. Watch the video. Donate to MS Research.
Yeah, absolutely. Meanwhile, W. Scottis 1 says, hello, Diamond Club. We, Bad Weave, and I have started a brand new Diamond Club community live stream. Us chat realmers get together every Tuesday following Night Attack, as well as on Friday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern, right after Current Geek, to play Jackbox games, you know, Quiplash, Murder Mystery Party, Gespionage, etc., and just hang out together as a community. Bad Weave will do the stream Tuesday nights, and I will stream Friday nights. We will sub for each other if one of us can't do our night. The goal is to always have a stream over at either twitch.tv/badweave or twitch.tv/wscottis1. We will be also simulcast to Muffin CDN as well for low latency, which is super important. What's unique about our stream and why we call it a community stream is that we have Discord voice chat. That's bit.ly/NADiscord on both of our streams. We hope to use this live stream in addition to help promote Diamond Club to new fans in the Twitch community. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Twitch is a wonderful platform. This is me talking now, Brian. He says, we've already been able to pick up new people from Twitch that we hope will join us at the main shows. If any of them happen to be here tonight, please give them a warm Diamond Club welcome. TLDR, Bad Weave and me doing streams on Tuesday and Friday nights. Be there. God, this makes me so happy, Justin. Like people ask, like every time I keep seeing, and there's plenty of names that pop up in the chat. They're like, what is this? Who are these guys or whatever? And yes, a lot of them are going to roll their eyes and leave, and you'll see message deleted, but they're out there, our people, and it's up to us to spread the good news and get them into the Diamond Club experience. And stuff like this is so, so important for doing that.
The lost diamonds.
The diamonds in the rough is what I like to think of them as.
They indeed are forever. And finally, Ping Pong A Call says, thank you for any help that anyone can offer. I really appreciate the help I've received from Brian and so many others. They have a link here. But... oh, this is the GoFundMe for cancer
call.
For a father of two.
This is a rough one, guys. And I want you to actually go to it. Do we have a shortened URL that's easy to read?
It's on diamondclub.reddit.com. You'll see Brian Brushwood suggested I post this here. It's a GoFundMe link from Ping Pong.
Yeah,
call.
And it's really rough. This is a story of somebody who's not looking for a cure. This is somebody who wants to leave enough money to take care of his family when he's gone. And he's now reached the point where, and this is a name and face I recognize from Twitter for a very, very long time. And he just wants a fund for his family. He's about halfway to his goal. Please take a look at it. It's heartbreaking and amazing. So, comment podcast.
Where you can shout out your projects. That is reddit.com/r/diamondclub or diamondclub.reddit.com, which leads us to the...
Welcome to Movie Minute, presented by CosmicRadio.tv for the week of March 27th, 2017. I'm your host, Roberto Villegas. You want to get Capone? Here's how you get Capone. He pulls a knife, you pull a gun. He sends one of yours to the hospital, you send one of his to the morgue. That's the Chicago way, and that's how you get Capone. Let's go check the scoreboard. Team Big and Tall, DTNS, and Night Attack are all tied for fourth place. Still waiting for the first film. Team Scotch Bros is in third place with chips bringing in $7.7 million a week. Team Cord Killers is in second place with life bringing in $12.5 million a week. And in first place, the Power Rangers bringing their total to $40.3 million. It's Team Frog Pants. And that is your Move Train Minute for the week of March 27th, 2017.
We've had a little time to sit on our picks. Tom, have you rethought your optimism for how you did?
No. No, I have not rethought it. I am still optimistic. I don't think I never want to say I have a lock on it because there's too much you just can't predict. But I think I've got a very, very solid lineup. I'm very happy with my lineup.
Yeah, what is your lineup?
I got Wonder Woman.
Smurfs, The Lost Village.
Of course I have Smurfs, The Diamonds in the Rough
Fate
Village.
Fate of the Furious is going to be very,
Fate and Wonder Woman are my strongholds. The rest is just kind of giving me a little padding.
Well, yeah. And also Captain Underpants had a really good trailer that dropped. Apparently it has a deeper connection to people as a book than I realized. So I think
I'll get some tens of millions out of it for sure.
And by the way, an overperformance by Power Rangers, which is I think kind of our first surprise of the summer.
We also
meanwhile it was Chips bitched for the Scotch Bros, a real underperformance. I think it was the seventh highest grossing movie this weekend. So. Ouch.
Not so good. Meanwhile,
the chips are down.
We ended up creating another stake bet yesterday on Cord Killers because you were convinced. I bet you a stake that Boss Baby would do double what Ghost in the Shell would.
That's right.
An R-rated anime remake, which is retreading versus mass marketed.
I think Ghost in the Shell is going to get enough people just because of the attention on it that it will do fine. And I think Boss Baby is going to tank.
Huh. All right. We'll find out.
I don't want it to tank.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Just saying, I think it might.
Meanwhile, congratulations to the...
My wife works for Rotten Tomatoes. But...
Oh, you've got inside sauce. No reviews have come out for either of them yet, have they? No. Okay, that'll matter.
Though, unless they came out today. But yeah, last I looked, they didn't.
Yeah, interesting. Man, anything else?
I don't know, Brian. What have we learned this week?
We learned that you and I have impressive stamina, and that at least there in the moment, everybody acted as though we were pretty funny, and we seem to be able to take direction. We're like they say, never work with children or animals. They worked with both.
Absolutely. Hey, we learned that Regina Hall either found us funny or is a very gracious liar.
Yep. And we learned that Tom Merritt continues to be a rad roommate and awesome enough to let us crash at his place.
Even if I don't see you, you can crash at my place.
Hey, man, I love you guys. See you next Tuesday.
Dying of fire. I'm allergic to bees. Oh, Justin Robert Young. Every time you go, I get so sad that I wanna drink a warm glass of Drano. Night attack, 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 night attack. Night attack. Night attack. I love you.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.